Hey, everyone. Good evening. It's good to see all of you on this Wednesday night. Did you bring your Bibles and your appetite? Yes? Okay. Aren't you glad for that truth that the joy of the Lord is our strength? I just love that. It's kind of a profound thing and yet kind of just a simple, straightforward thing. I look at how many times in Scripture we you know, there seems to be these paradoxical truths, you know, these statements that, you know, in our natural mind, we kind of go, wait a minute, how does that work, you know? If you want to gain your life, Jesus said, lose it for my sake. You know, if you want to be great in God's kingdom, be the servant of all. Seems so mutually exclusive. And that's one of those things, the joy of the Lord is my strength. And, you know, there's times when we're just going through the most difficult things in life, and we feel like, you know, we may even be despairing, and yet there's something about the Christian life when you have the Holy Spirit that the joy that comes from the Lord is your strength. And it's not just paint on a happy face and pretend you're not going through a hard time, you know. It's just something precious to a child of God, that God, I often say it this way, that Christian joy rises above circumstances, and it's a supernatural thing because it comes out of the nature of God and it doesn't depend on circumstances. And so it's just amazing to me how in the middle of the tough stuff, we can have the joy of the Lord. And so many times that is the very thing that is our strength. Amen? It's good stuff. Okay, open up to Jeremiah, and we're going to continue our look at this book. And, you know, it's interesting, speaking of the joy of the Lord as our strength, I often, you know, as we go through Jeremiah, obviously it's kind of a heavy book. God's dealing with his people. He's pronouncing that they're going to go into captivity because they've basically just been stubborn and rebellious, and they're going to experience the chastening of the Lord through that. And yet, sprinkled all the way through are always these statements of hope and reassurance that even though tough days are coming, number one, you could choose to repent right now and not experience the captivity. That is an option. Or even if you choose to be stubborn and go into captivity, remember that's not the end of the story. You know, there's times that we're going through difficult things that in a sense we've reaped what we've sown. But God's speaking through Jeremiah so that when they're in captivity and then they read what Jeremiah wrote and later, and years later, they will remember. Oh, for example, Jeremiah 11. Or Jeremiah 29:11, it says, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. And then it goes on, it says, so seek me with all of your heart, and if you do, you'll find me. Now, can you imagine being in captivity for 70 years in Babylon and just feeling like this is just it, you know, God's done with us, and how that could fill you with hope, realizing, okay, it's not always going to be this way. And give you joy that would be your strength in the midst of that seemingly hopeless situation. And God is just so faithful to demonstrate mercy, even in the midst of severe things in life, when we're learning tough lessons and going through hard times. He just is always reaching out in his mercy. I love that. Well, we looked at kind of I presented to you and sort of an outline of the book, and it's a little bit of a weird one, kind of lopsided. It just, the first chapter is the preparation of Jeremiah. Chapters 2 all the way to 51 is the proclamations of Jeremiah. Okay, it's all of these proclamations, all of these prophecies in which, you know, and they're all against Israel and Judah, and he's denouncing them for their faithlessness. He's calling them to repentance. He's warning of judgment. There's these sermons about spiritual complacency. He tells them, look, this destruction isn't permanent. We'll see along the way that there's a new covenant that's coming, a new kind of arrangement that God has. He's going to replace the old covenant with a new covenant of hope, and it's all about relationship. And all of these things, and then just the very last chapter, 52, is basically all of these predictions are fulfilled. And it's kind of just a quick recap and sum up of everything. So the preparation of Jeremiah, the proclamations of Jeremiah, and the prediction of Jeremiah. I want to dive right into chapter 3 is where we left off last time. And he says, they say if a man divorces his wife and she goes from him and becomes another man's, may he return to her again. Would not that land be greatly polluted? But you have played the harlot with many lovers, yet return to me, says the Lord. Lift up your eyes to the desolate heights and see, where have you not lain with men? By the road you've sat for them like an Arabian in the wilderness, and you have polluted the land with your harlotries and your wickedness. Therefore, the showers have been withheld, and there's been no latter rain. You've had a harlot's forehead. You refuse to be ashamed. Will you not from this time cry to me? My father, you are the guide of my youth. Will he remain angry forever? Will he keep it to the end? Behold, you have spoken and done evil things as you were able. And the Lord said also to me in the days of Josiah the king, have you seen what backsliding Israel has done? She has gone up on every high mountain and under every green tree, and there played the harlot. And I said, after she had done all these things, return to me. But she did not return. And her treacherous sister Judah saw it. And then I saw that for all the causes for which backsliding Israel had committed adultery, I had put her away and given her a certificate of divorce. Yet her treacherous sister Judah did not fear, but went and played the harlot also. So it came to pass through her casual harlotry that she defiled the land and committed adultery with stones and trees. And yet for all this, her treacherous sister Judah was not turned to me with her whole heart, but in pretense, says the Lord. And the Lord said to me, backsliding Israel has shown herself more righteous than treacherous Judah. Go and proclaim these words toward the north and say, return, backsliding Israel, says the Lord. I will not cause my anger to fall on you, for I am merciful, says the Lord. I will not remain angry forever. Only acknowledge your iniquity that you have transgressed against the Lord your God and have scattered your charms to alien deities under every green tree, and you have not obeyed my voice, says the Lord. Return, O backsliding children, says the Lord, for I am married to you. I will take you, one from a city and two from a family, and I will bring you to Zion, and I will give you shepherds according to my heart who will feed you with knowledge and understanding. And so the Lord addresses Israel and Judah and their harlotry. Now, of course, there was physical harlotry and adultery going on in marriage, and family life was in shambles, and certainly there was literally that sort of, you know, sexual immorality that was rampant and all of this that just became so characteristic of the culture. But what he's talking about in the bigger picture in eternity is spiritual harlotry. He's saying, you are mine, and you've forsaken me. Your God, your husband, as it were, and you've chased after other deities, other gods, and there was this idolatry of heart. When he says you've committed harlotry with rocks and trees, you think, what does that mean? And it's just, they were worshiping false gods, you know, Mother Earth, that sort of a thing. I mean, it was their hearts were going after false gods. And from God's point of view, that's the same thing as if, you know, you're married and you step out on your spouse and you're unfaithful to your vows, to your commitment. And he's saying, this is what's happening spiritually with my people. And yet, did you hear that phrase repeated over and over again? He acknowledges, he's calling out their sin. He's saying, backsliding Israel. Okay, and yet the mercy, but come back, come back. I love you. I want you still, even to this day. I want you and I love you and just come back, you know. And I see in our culture today such similarities between Judah back then and our own country today. You know, I'm not going to chase this down in every instance, but You know, we have ruled God out of our national life, out of our public life, out of every institution, you know, that our country was founded upon, the Judeo-Christian values, all of it. It's like, we don't want you anymore, God. We want to serve other gods, the gods of, you know, money, the gods of materialism, the gods of, you know, sexual freedom or whatever, you know. And there's all these things, and it's like, we don't want to have God speak to those issues in life. And this so-called freedom that we have to push God out ultimately ends up with bondage in our lives, because we become enslaved to sin. And what, you know, the way an individual goes is the way a culture goes eventually. I mean, culture is made up of individuals, and so there's this repentance on an individual level for sure that God is calling them to, but on it, literally on a national scale. And I look at our country today. How many of you know this isn't a Christian nation? It's not a Christian nation. And the reason is because we no longer, you know, it's not characteristic of our nation to have Christian individuals that are really living out the Christian life. Of course, there are, you know, but it's no longer characteristic. It's no longer a cultural value, you know, that are anchored in you know, what the Bible says is good for the flourishing of humankind. And so we've pushed God out of public life, out of national life, out of institutions of higher learning and education, all of these things. Of course, there's this, it's really interesting how, you know, we've tried to push even like something like the Pledge of Allegiance, one nation under God. I saw something, did you guys see this year? Somebody was publicly, I forget what it was with the context, but somebody who was saying the Pledge of Allegiance publicly, but they were not, you know, they obviously, you know, weren't Christians, and they said one nation, and then they started to say under God, and they went one nation, indivisible with liberty and justice for all. Heaven forbid that they say under God on camera. And I just thought, isn't that interesting? You know, this thing that we've repeated, you know, as a cultural value, for all of us grew up with that, right? And now all of a sudden it's so politically incorrect to say under God. It's like, we dare not say that. And so we've really blatantly pushed that out. One, there's of course all kinds of polls and research out there, but that most people, when I say most, some of the stuff that I looked at, 65 to 70% probably, don't even believe in right and wrong anymore. Absolutes, moral absolutes. This is right, you know, there's such a thing as right and wrong. It's sort of this existential worldview. There's no, you know, whatever's right for you is your thing, and don't push that on me, and whatever's right for me is what's right for me. And there's no standard. And this is what's going on. We see it in the Bible. This is what Israel and Judah did, is they, it's like, we don't want God to weigh in on what's right and wrong. And so, you know, some people have suggested that if things keep going the direction they are, that God, you know, you've heard this. A lot of leaders say this, you know, if things keep going the way that they are, God's going to judge America. And I, honestly, I mean, I don't mean to be doom and gloom, but honestly, I think it's already happening. I just think we're not aware of it. I think we're reaping what we've sowed, and there's you know, and here's a couple of why I say that. The first reason is because one of the first indicators that God has decided to judge a nation, according to Romans 1, is it says that he turns them over. He turns them over to their desires. This is what you want? Okay, this is what you get. You know, and he just turns them over to their desires. And that's an evidence that judgment has begun. He gives us up to our desires. There's a great historian. His name is Arnold Toynbee, who did a study of world, you know, was famous for his, just wrote hundreds of books and stuff on history. And he said out of 22 civilizations that have appeared in the history of the world, 19 collapsed when they reached the present moral condition of the United States of America. That's pretty sobering to think about. But there's this verse here. What is verse 14? Return, he says, O backsliding children. Chapter 3, verse 22, same message. Or the same chapter later, verse 22, same message. Return, you backsliding children, and I will heal your backsliding. Now, did you know the term backsliding actually just comes from the Bible? It's where we see it. It's all over the Old Testament. And it simply means that you've left your original position. And so God's appealing to them. He's saying, don't you remember the good old days? Don't you remember when there was a love for God and you knew my love and there was just this trust in the love of God? Don't you remember how you trusted me? But you've left me. You've left your original position. You've forgotten where you've come from. You forgot what I brought you out of and the promise of where I'm taking you. You've left me. God never left them, but they left God. And so I think that's one of the things that you're going to see over and over. And Jeremiah, as we said before, is very sort of colorful in his language. He likes object lessons and metaphors, these word pictures, and it's very effective. And there are, I think, 21 different metaphors for judgment that Jeremiah just alone uses. For example, go to chapter 4, verse 3. He says, for thus says the Lord to the men of Judah and Jerusalem, break up your fallow ground and do not sow among the thorns. Now, every winter in that land, in that kind of desert area, every winter, you know, they have the rainy season. And when that stops, the last part of the winter, what the farmers do is they go out and they break up the fallow ground. Okay? And they basically till it up and they remove the weeds and the thorns and the debris and the rocks. And what they're doing is they're preparing the soil to plant the seed for a new harvest. They're making the ground soft again. And basically the prophet is saying that. He says, soften your heart. Do you have a soft heart? Does God have the freedom to speak into your life and say the things that he wants to say and that you desperately need to hear? Or have you become hard-hearted? And the writer of Hebrews puts it this way. He says, beware. He says, don't become hardened. Don't let your hearts become hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. And that can happen. Remember, Jesus gave the parable of the sower and the seed. And I call it the parable of the soils. Because there's a sower, and it says, behold, a sower went out to sow, and he scattered some seed. And he talks about four different soils. And there's nothing wrong with the sower or the seed, but what where the variable comes in is the soil. And Jesus' point was, he was talking about the heart. He said, what kind of heart do you have? And some are hard-hearted. And other soil has rocks, bedrock. So in a hard heart, the seed, God's word just sits on the top, on the soil. You hear the word of God, you hear some preacher, and it just kind of sits there. Doesn't penetrate. You go out unchanged, unmoved, not impacted at all. Or maybe you just go out ticked off. You say, oh, I can't believe that guy that said that, you know, and who does he think he is? And you just, not interested. Then there's the other soil, he said, where it's rocky soil, and they would have understood it to be bedrock in their, in you know, where they lived. So you could have a shallow soil, and a seed that's planted, the roots go down and it springs up quickly. But then the roots hit bedrock and they can't go deep enough to really get the moisture and the nutrients and so forth. So the sun comes and Jesus said it beats down and pew, you know, it wilts. And a lot of people, that's what it's like. Whee, I'm a Christian, you know, and they start to go through kind of the heat of trials and they wilt and they wither really quickly. Because their roots aren't going deep into the Word of God. It's just kind of this superficial thing, this kind of splashy thing, you know, that, you know, I go to church, but I'm not really feeding my soul the word of God. And so if the condition of your heart, you don't have a spiritual appetite, you're really not interested in sinking your roots into the truth of God's word. If you're selective and you say, well, I believe this, but I don't believe that. I'll listen to God over here, but not that. And you're just kind of, then those roots can't go down deep. And all of this contributes to backsliding, okay? All of this contributes to us drifting away from God. And our heart, we're talking about the heart. And then Jesus said there's the soil that, you know, the weeds and thorns and everything kind of choke it out. So you have something grow up quickly. But then the cares of this world, he says, the deceitfulness of riches, there's just things in everyday life that sort of choke us out and we wither. He says, but there's the good soil. And when the seed falls on good soil, man, strong roots, lots of fruits. And that was, you know, what Jesus was getting at. And in this context here, it's a similar idea. It's Jeremiah's talking about soil, and he's saying, hey, let's till up this hard pan, you know, this fallow ground. Let's kind of get down to the good stuff. Let's be soft. Henry Ironside said this. He's a great preacher and teacher and commentator of a previous generation. He said, the plowshare of conviction must overturn the hardened soil of the heart. Now, when you hear something from God's word and you feel condemned, like, oh, I'm such a loser, you know. I can't, you know, God doesn't love me. Be careful, because what happens is your own sinful nature can kind of mess with your mind. Whenever you're hearing truth, sin will creep up and kind of take its starting point right there. Oh, God says this, well, let's go do that instead. And then the enemy, of course, also lies to us. And he wants us to feel, as my mom used to say, dumb, cheap, stupid, and ugly. You know, and that's, she spent a lot of years feeling dumb, cheap, stupid, and ugly because of the life that she lived before she knew the Lord. And even after she knew the Lord, she says, you know, sometimes the enemy just comes to me and he just reminds me of my past and he makes me, I just feel so bad, you know. And pretty soon she's, beep, she's in the ditch, you know, emotionally, because all she's thinking of is the past. And she's not thinking of who she is in Christ today. Did you know that if you're a Christian, this is just mind blower to me. Jesus, when he died on the cross, he paid for your sins, past, present, and get this, future. It's so thorough. What Jesus did on the cross completely covers all of your sin. The Bible says the blood of Jesus Christ cleanses a man from all sin. And I don't know about you, but sometimes I can be surprised at how sinful I am. Even after all these years, I think, oh, I know better than that. Why did I do that? And then I feel kind of beat up and condemned, and the Lord says, I'm not condemning you, but I do want you to have a deeper appreciation for my grace, because I forgave even that, John. I've forgiven you. You're forgiven. You're absolutely righteous in Christ. If you're a Christian, the Bible says you've been justified. It's as if you'd never sinned, because Jesus never sinned, and his righteousness is given to your account. When God looks at you through the blood of his son Jesus, he says, righteous. Now, we're still in the process of learning how to walk in righteousness and live out this life of obedient faith and love, right? And we stumble along the way. But from God's point of view, the Bible's very clear about this. You are righteous positionally in Christ. That's why the Bible says, put on Christ. And it's this sense of Jesus, when God looks at you, he sees the righteous life of his son Jesus. He says, I like that. I love you. That's good. I'm pleased with you. But as you grow and study scripture, there's going to be times where you read hard things, where God says, plow up the fallow ground. You're kind of hard-hearted in this area. And he's not telling you that to condemn you. He's telling you that to convict you. Conviction will always draw you back to Christ and the cross. It'll always, it just gives you a greater appreciation. It's like, yeah, I want to please God. Lord, help me please you. I'm sorry. Thank you that you've forgiven me. You don't have to do anything to earn it. You don't have to just try harder. It's done. It's paid in full, Jesus said. But the reason the instructions are still there and the warnings are still there, and we look through the Old Testament and the New Testament, you've got to look at the Old Testament through the gospel of the New Testament, through the lens of the New Testament, and realize he's dealing with some difficult things with his people, but he loves them. He absolutely loves them. And he's always in his mercy calling them back. But he does address their heart condition. He says, you know what? You're hard-hearted. That's why you're backsliding. That's why you're committing spiritual adultery. Because you're choosing to live in a lifestyle of sin. And it's just that hard-heartedness. And he says, come on back. Come on back. That's the message to his people. So let the conviction of God dig into your heart. And that's just such an important concept. So chapter 5 and 6. So I'm moving along quick tonight. I'm just telling you. I'm just picking out these kind of little truths because, and that's one that jumped out to me in chapter 4. In chapter 5 and 6, this was given kind of during the early reforms of the first king. Remember we talked about there were a number of kings that reigned during the time of Jeremiah. I think there was 5 of them. Josiah was one of them, and he was a good king. He was a good king, and he brought a measure of revival and a measure of reform. But the deal is, it was superficial. It just didn't last very long. And so there was sort of this emotional response, and people kind of jumped on the bandwagon. And you see this even in the church today. Have you seen certain, I'll just call them fads, spiritual fads that blow through the church sometimes? And everybody jumps on it. And it's like, whee, this is great, you know, revival. Everybody says revival. And then like within a few weeks or months or maybe a year, it's like, okay, let's wait till he comes out with the next best-selling book, you know, that particular author or whatever. And I'm not trying to be mean-spirited or critical or cynical or any of that. I'm just saying that you have to take a little bit of the long view, I guess, and be discerning. Because there's lots of good things that come in, and it's a blessing. No, I'm sure it's a blessing to many people. But what I have to do, what you have to do, is personally just say, is this transforming my life? Is, you know, revival is something that isn't just short-lived, quick, superficial, and emotional. That's not revival. Revival is when there's new life. Your heart is changed and your life is changed and you will know it and others will know it, and it's something that lasts. It's something that is so transformative. And there's an old saying, any pig can fly in a hurricane. You know, and it's funny. If you just get enough wind blowing, you know. And that's what happens sometimes. I think a lot of things that kind of pass as revival really isn't a revival at all. It's just kind of emotionalism. And I think that was one of the problems in Jeremiah's time. In chapter 6, verse 13, he says, because from the least of them, even to the greatest of them, everyone is given to covetousness. And from the prophet, even to the priest, everyone deals falsely. And they have also healed the hurt of my people slightly, saying, peace, peace, when there is no peace. And so so there were a couple of groups back then that Jeremiah was dealing with, and similar to what we deal with today. There were politicians and there were prophets. And so the problem is, the prophets, for the most part, were false prophets. And what happened is these people wanted to spare. Remember, Babylon is breathing down their necks. They know that they're in danger of being taken over by Babylon. And so the politicians come along and they try to make them feel better about themselves and say, well, you know, that's not, you know, we just need to, the way to deal with this is we got to form some alliances with Egypt or some alliances with Syria. And then the solution to this problem is to kind of link arms with these people. And that's how we're going to solve the problem. And the prophets, then, just like now, they're preaching feel-good messages, fun messages, telling people what they want to hear. Everything's okay. Don't panic. Well, God told Jeremiah to go to the people and say, this is very serious. You need to repent and come back to me, or else Babylon's coming. And you're going to reap what you've sown. You're going to experience bondage. And the false prophets are saying, oh, don't listen to Jeremiah, cranky old prophet. He doesn't know what he's talking about. And they were saying, peace, peace, and there is no peace. And what happens is, I came across this description. I think it describes this description of our world in many ways, and some of these spiritual leaders and politicians. He said this. He said, the world is like a ship that is sinking. They don't know it, but the captain knows it. He knows the ship is sinking. So the captain turns to the whole group of people on the boat and he says, okay, let me just tell you, all the rules are dropped now. If you're in second or third class, you can move up to first class free of charge. All the drinks are free. You can have as much booze as you want. You can party in the dining hall if you like, play soccer in the dining room. If you break the lamps, we don't care. We want you to have a good time. So what will all of the people on the boat think who don't know the ship is sinking? They're going to say, hey, 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 we like this captain. Cool captain. That's what they're going to think. He gives us so much freedom. He's so nice, so much fun. And they don't know. They're dying. The ship's going down. The nation was sinking. Okay? That's the context. The nation was sinking. It was going down. And you got these false prophets and these politicians. And they're only slightly healing the people. In other words, they're trying to comfort them just with words. It's going to be okay. Don't panic. And the prophet, and God's saying, repent. The ship's going down. Well, you come to chapters 7 through 10. And I always try to look at this and, okay, Lord, what are you saying for our day and age? What are you saying to me personally? And there are things in our life. And again, God's not condemning, but he's warning that if you continue on a certain path, there's just very predictable the kinds of bondage that come. And if you fiddle around with things that God says, hey, that's not good for you, and start substituting your relationship with Jesus with other things, then he says that's to the downfall of your life. That'll destroy you. So he's always calling back. He says, I've got something better in Jesus. I have your best in mind. I know what will make your life blessed and thriving and flourish. And so come back to me. In chapters 7 through 10, these are known as the temple discourses. And I bet you can guess why. Because they took place at the temple. Okay, he had to go preach God's message in a place where they should have been getting it. They should have been getting good teaching and good spiritual leadership and all these things, but they weren't. And so God sends Jeremiah up to the gates of the temple. He gives him a message to the people who are going into church, going to temple. In chapter 7, verse 2, he says, stand in the gate of the Lord's house and proclaim there this word and say, hear the word of the Lord, all you of Judah who enter into these gates to worship the Lord. Thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, amend your ways and your doings, and I will cause you to dwell in this place. Do not trust in these lying words. The temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord are these. And so the idea back then was that people were saying, hey, as long as we go to church, we're good. And they were just going through religious motions. And, you know, they had to go three times a year, God said, for the feast days. Remember Passover, Pentecost, and Tabernacles, I think it was? You got to go there three times a year. worship at these three feast times. And so they were just, that's what they're saying. Hey, we're going to church, temple of the Lord. We're good. We're good with God. And for them, what had happened, and what Jeremiah was pointing out, is God cared about the substance. They were going through religious motions, but they weren't really submitted to the Lord. They weren't really worshiping Him, loving Him. And so there was this ritual that was done in a particular place, and God, through the prophet, is saying, I want to have a personal relationship with you. It's not about religion or a ritual. It's about a relationship. It's not about a place. It's about a person, see? And it's the same to this day. We can go to church and we think, well, oh, I jumped through that hoop, checked that box, and we can miss the substance. And we're coming to God on kind of a superficial level, and yet, do you realize how precious it is that we can have a relationship with Jesus? Amen. I mean, that's such an amazing thing. He invites prayer. The fact that we can actually come boldly to the throne of grace and find mercy and help in time of need. The fact that we can talk with our Creator, with the God of the universe. And we can be reminded day by day that He's good, that He loves us. He has our best in mind. There's mercies that are new every morning. I mean, this is an amazing thing. And we substitute that for religion, just going through the motions. Oh, if I could encourage you, spend time, quality and quantity time, just relating with Christ. Open up the Bible. Meditate on the Word. Spend time with Jesus. See it as this personal, intimate time. Confess to Him. One of my big brothers in the Lord was sharing the other day. He was just sharing with some guys, and he was saying, you know, I love Jesus even more than my wife, and that's a lot because I really love my wife. But he says, I can tell my wife most things, but it's probably not going to be a blessing to her if I tell her every single thought of my heart. And he wasn't talking about hiding things or being dishonest with his wife. He was just saying that I can literally, for God sees my heart, I can literally talk to Him about anything and everything. And because I'm completely covered in Christ, I don't have to worry or be ashamed or embarrassed or afraid or think He's going to condemn me. Now, He doesn't wink at sin. Clearly, He died for it, so He took it serious. But because it's already been paid for, I now, as a believer, I can come to Jesus and I can tell Him the secrets of my heart. I'm struggling with sin. I can talk about it. See, I don't have anybody to talk to. Yes, you do. You can talk to Jesus. You can talk to Jesus. And today I was doing that. I was finding my mind going. I was working through some stuff. And I was finding my mind just going in a sinful direction. And I was reminded, I was so glad that this brother had shared that, because I was able to kind of stop. The Holy Spirit said, John, I've called you to love, and I've called you to trust me. And you're starting to go in a direction that it will rob you of peace and joy and my very best. Pray about that situation. Pray about that relationship. Pray about that person and confess. And I was able to just say, Lord, You're so right. Again, as usual. Man, I'm just a stinker, man. I'm just so proud, so selfish. And I tend towards just unbelief, and I just went, yeah, that's right, Lord, forgive me. And I just started confessing all of this stuff, and at the same time just thanking Him. God, thank You. Thank You that You already know what I'm telling You, and You've already forgiven it. And And I just felt this weight lift. It was like, oh, and I'm so glad that I'm invited into this intimacy with the Lord, that I can just be totally honest. I don't have to hide anything. I don't have to feel condemned at all that I am totally sinning right now. I can just repent of it. I can just say, you know what? You're right, God. That's wrong. Change my heart. Change my attitude. Help me to please you, to love you, to trust you. And I'm telling you, we're talking about the substance of worship. And we can get into this religious routine and God just says, nope, I got something far superior for you. But you got to repent of that. I'm not interested in the religious routine. I'm interested in an authentic relationship that's honest. And it's only by his grace that we can have that. And what a joy. What a joy. I don't care if you've been walking with the Lord for 50 years. And so, though, if you have been walking with the Lord for 50 years, you know exactly what I'm talking about, right? You're still capable. I don't know what this is in our minds. We think that after we get old, we just become sweet and mature. And we just love everybody. And we never struggle with temptation. Can I hear a sanctified baloney? It's just not true. You could be just an old sinner. We perfect our craft over the years, you know. But again, that should make grace all the sweeter. Amen? I mean, that should just make us want to draw even closer to Jesus. That, man, God, you have put up with my shenanigans all these decades, and here I am, and I'm old enough to know better, and we know that, but here I am again, Lord, needing your grace and mercy and forgiveness, and please, please, you know. And he's like, yep, and it's right there in abundant supply, like just like it always is. He doesn't excuse it. Those aren't excuse. You know, it's not, I'm not saying that we knowingly live in sin and just kind of comfort ourselves with, oh, it's forgiven. If you understand grace, you don't do that. You don't take advantage of God's grace. You grow in your appreciation of it, though, I think, over the years. And that's one of the things that I'm learning. And so here's something that's just kind of crazy. Did you see verse 16 of chapter 7? He says, therefore, do not pray for this people, nor lift up a cry or prayer for them, nor make intercession to me, for I will not hear you. Yikes. You know, that's the only place in the Bible that I see anything like that. It's a little bit of a, okay, Lord, what does that mean? It just is a stunning statement. But apparently, I mean, God said it. There's a point. There's something similar to it back in, the story of Noah, where God says, my spirit will not strive with man forever. In other words, there is a point where God says, okay, like he did with Pharaoh, you want a hard heart? You got a hard heart. But it was only after Pharaoh hardened his heart. And you read that in the Exodus story, you read that over and over and over and over. Pharaoh hardened his heart. And God comes along and says, okay, that's what you want, that's what you get. That's a really scary place to be. But here's the thing, again, I say, if you're concerned about this, maybe you're struggling with this in some area of life, don't hear what I just said as, oh, great. Then I've gone so far that I'm just, you know, irredeemable, because I have had a hard heart, truth be told. Pastor, are you telling me that God's just given me over to a hard heart and there's no use even coming to God? Don't pray for me. That's not what I'm saying. But I think that this verse is in the Bible because, again, when God warns the people that he loves, he's not making idle threats. He's just saying ahead of time, look, this will destroy you. I'm warning you. Don't go that far. And if you're concerned about it, then that's good. You're probably feeling some conviction. The proper response is just to come quickly to Jesus and say, Lord, will you deal with my hard heart? Will you give me a soft heart? Will you give me, you know, help me to trust you with this thing that is creating such, you know, bitterness in me? And you just, repentance is such a good thing, you guys. Satan wants us to think that if we have to repent, then God's just really ticked off at us. Peter said, repent so times of refreshing may come. I mean, this is the key to experience. Just God starts to just unload his grace and mercy on people who are humble and they're willing to repent. Well, I'm going to stop there. And what I want to do is just take some time as we kind of segue into worship, and ask you to consider with me this very thing that maybe the Lord is calling you to repentance in some area, but maybe you've been afraid because you have this idea that he's mad at you, that he's condemning you, that he's just going to whack you. And I just want to reiterate that there's grace, there's mercy, there's forgiveness. And the hardest heart can be made soft by the grace of God. And so I'm encouraging you that as we continue in worship, if the Lord has started, if something's underway in your heart, and there's something that has been shared from the Word tonight that's just resonating with you, and you feel like the Lord's calling you back to your original position, or just maybe calling to him in the first place. Maybe there's an area where you can see your tracks. You've backslidden. You say, I want to get back there. I want to get to that place where I'm just experiencing the grace and mercy of God, the joy of the Lord, the forgiveness of God. It doesn't have to take a long time. It can just be in a moment of time if you'll trust his word. Lord, I thank you for your word tonight. Thank you for the message of hope and salvation, a message of grace and mercy and forgiveness, even in the midst of this difficult book of prophecy that just is such a heartbreak in so many ways. And yet it's hopeful because in the midst of this kind of the backsliding ways and the stubbornness and the rebellion of Israel and Judah, there's this merciful God. You're there. We hear your voice. We see it clearly. You're calling them back. And Lord, I pray that we could just kind of apply that in our own lives tonight, that you would, if there's any here, Lord, who are just struggling and they're feeling just too far gone or maybe beyond the reach of your grace, please, Lord, I pray that you'd give them the faith to believe that that you're there. And just like the father opened his arms to the returning prodigal son, you're there. And yet, Lord, if there's some that maybe aren't quite there and they're still running the other way, and I pray that you'd convict them and that you would just produce a godly sorrow that leads to repentance, and that they would be willing to turn and face you and let you soften their heart. And we just thank you, Lord, that your grace and truth alone can do that. The power of your Spirit is what we need to do that deep work. So help us, Lord, in Jesus' name.